If you can't let go of that old season, your hands are full and he can't give you what he wants to give you. Hi everyone, we're back again with our weekly Webisode. And today, this is Fitret, and I'll introduce, she's my wife. She's one of the pastors in the Royals Church. And my name's Adem, Xhafer. We've been married for 44 years, running church. Today we'll talk a little bit about, we've been full-time in ministry for 30 years plus now. And so we're gonna be talking on that. But I wanna encourage you in your circles today. You know, we're speaking to people who are meeting in circles. On Sundays, we sit in rows, but when we have our circles, different days of the week, we're sitting in circles and we can see each other. And that's exciting. So today, when you're meeting with your circle, it's a great opportunity just to look into each other's eyes and really feel the heartbeat of each person in your group. Is that correct, Fitri?
That's true. So good, and it's exciting what God's doing, beginning to do. He started and he's going to continue building our circles in our city, and we're believing God that there'll be a circle to begin with in every suburb and then increase in every suburb as well. So I think that's really exciting, hey, to just be prayerful on it and believe God that we're going to raise up leaders that will run great circles. So we're really excited about that. On Sunday, we celebrated 30 years of full-time ministry. That's half my life. I thought about it, half of my life. Started full-time when I was 30, and 30 years, it seems a long time, but it kind of, I don't know how you feel, but I feel like we've just started. That's how I feel. That I kind of feel excited at what God is gonna do, like in this near future. And yeah, it's really exciting. And I keep thinking of Pastor Gary's prophetic message about the butterfly, a new church emerging. So
Gary Swenson.
Who did I say?
Gary.
Yeah, Pastor Gary. Yeah. So that's really exciting. So we shared a lot about our journey. We could only fit in so much on Sunday, but we kind of picked the most, you know, building churches, buying property, renting, doing rallies and outreaches and crusades overseas, and talked a lot about your journey of overseas travel with Ola Maid and Feed the Hungry and all those, you know, what you did in those years. And then we're here today. So we're going to talk about three things today that we believe are guiding principles for our life. And as we hold on to tightly, and we want to encourage you to also hold on to that. And the first one was the call of God. Can you remember the first time that you felt the call of God?
I do. I never mention it on Sunday, but I remember it's 40 years ago, so we're talking such a long time ago. But I remember I'd only been saved maybe a month or two, maybe a month and something like that. And we moved into this old house. And I remember doing something that I hadn't done, but I went and knelt beside my bed and began to pray. And I felt the power of God came as I began to pray. And I had a vision. It's the very first time I've had a vision that I can recall. That was my first vision in my life. But as I was kneeling there, I had a vision as if I, from a different perspective, I could see myself kneeling at the bed. Mm. And it's like, this is what I saw, like a dove, a white dove, holding this purple mantle. But it was like almost transparent, but purple. And it was hovering a few meters above me, and it released the purple mantle, and the purple mantle just really slowly, slowly, gently just came down and rested on my shoulders. And I never forgot that. And I had a sense in my heart then that it was not a word from God, but a sign that I'm calling you to serve me in this capacity. So that's really my first recollection of the call of God.
Yeah, because like salvation's one thing, but then the call of God is like a separate.
What about you, Fitra?
Me?
What's your recollection of the first time?
My thing, and I'll still remember it to this day, it was at Mariba High School. Interesting. This is before we started church.
That's like 30 years ago.
Yeah, would it have been? Yeah. No, this is before we started.
Before we started, so more than
so. I remember
years.
Uncle Joe was preaching, and there was not a lot of, probably 30 people in the room, and I was sitting up the back because I had kids. And he had this message about, you know, when Jesus said, go to this place and then you'll see two donkeys tied up. Mm. I'm not a donkey, but...
No, but the story.
But the story. He used, in that story, he said, go and untie the donkey because I have need of...
I have need of it.
I have need of the donkey, because then he was going to come down the street and they were singing Hosanna. Yeah. And the words for me was, I have need of you. That was my beginning of my calling. I didn't kind of really, I thought, oh no, not me. You know how we always think, not me. I'm not. Gideon was the same. I'm the least in all my clan. We always have excuses, but for me, that was the beginning of my call.
I remember that night really clearly.
Yeah.
And Uncle Joe kept asking, well, you know, will that person come to the front? I want to pray. And you kept looking around, like, who is that person? I wonder who that person can't be. And then finally, you got
I was
up.
Like inside, it was like someone had a hammer inside of
it
me.
Was and pounding.
Was pounding.
Yeah.
Like inside of me, that was like the Holy Spirit just...
And you knew
trying to get my attention.
You had to go out.
And I was looking at everyone in front of me and thinking, why won't anyone move? Like, this is pretty powerful, because I was feeling it. And I thought, why don't they move and just go and get it, like, so this can be over with?
Mm.
But I was actually the person. And remember, we went home after that and we had a big party. We told everyone to come over to our house and we all kind of 30 or 40 people gathered. It was fun. So from then on, it's been a journey, but we're not going there today. But I think about Moses, his call when he had fled Egypt and he was in the wilderness and God came to him out of a burning bush. How amazing is God that he chooses whatever he wants to do, hey? Like Moses, he is God and he turns around in this burning bush and God's speaking to him out of that burning bush.
I think
so exciting.
With Moses, I think it's important to recognize, and it may be you're the listener, you're listening about the call of God, and I'm sure that the call of God goes out to, look, everyone is called to do something.
Yeah.
It's not about you're better or worse because you're a pastor or a singer, a musician, an administrator or a prophet or any of those things. Doesn't make anybody better.
Mm.
Just means it's a specific and unique call for that person. But people are called by God way back. And I have memories in my own life. I'm not going to go to me, my memories, but I will go to this. When Moses' parents saw their child,
they knew that.
The words in the King James was they saw that he was a proper
child.
There was something about they recognized, they said, the Pharaoh's word is kill them, kill all the baby boys. And they said, we're not going to do that.
Yeah.
If it means that he dies, he'll die in the river, but we're not going to do it with our own hands. But they said, but if God is on this child and the call of God is on this young child, then God knows how to preserve that child. So it started with the parents that they recognized he was called. It's then Moses sort of has this sense of, I hate what I'm seeing with the oppression of the Jews. And he felt like he needed to jump in and he murdered an Egyptian to stop the oppression. So he knew that he had to do something, but that wasn't it. That
wasn't,
was the wrong thing to do. And you may be doing the wrong thing at different times because of how you are mentally and the way you've been brought up. But ultimately, Moses, I'll come back to your story with the burning bush. That's when he heard the voice of God and the call
out of
God
of the bush.
Very clearly. Time for you to go, Moses, and deliver my people 80
gets
years
your
later.
Eh?
Wow.
Gets your attention like a burning bush. You can't actually, you can't do anything much I like about that, can you? That's pretty definite, hey? Like a voice, people hear the voice of God.
It's clear.
David's was interesting because the prophet Samuel, God told him, go and anoint David. So that was through a prophet. Isaiah's call came through a vision. Remember, Isaiah was said, in the year of King Uzziah's reign, I was in
he
the
died.
Lord. Yeah, he was in the house and he saw a vision. He saw the Lord high and lifted up. And we know that story. It goes on to say how he said, I'm undone. Like he realized how his whole life was just not right. And how the angel came and with the coals off the altar. So everybody's call is different. You just got to know and identify that time when you knew that that time was the moment. I know my time and you know your time, and know
multiple,
that moment.
And multiple times God keeps calling us, drawing us into our destiny.
Yeah.
You know, and ultimately we call that first point, embrace the call.
Yeah.
So embrace means to tightly hug.
Encompass and circle.
Encircle it.
So circle. So
I just feel,
guard it. Yeah.
I just feel to pray just briefly for you, because your call is real and you may not even have understood when God was calling you. So Father, I just want to pray right now for every person listening to this webisode. Father, I pray for them, Lord, and I bless them with this, that they should know, see, comprehend, understand, and identify the call of God on their life for what they're meant to do to serve you.
Yes,
in Jesus'
Lord.
Name.
Thank
Amen.
You, Lord. Amen. You know, once you know the call of God on your life, the next step for us was that we were available to serve in the church. We did everything that we could do to help pastors and help wherever we were. We just took on anything, because it's through the call of God where you begin to serve. But in that serving, you get to find out you fulfill the destiny upon your life. That we found that as well, that as we served in church in whatever capacity that was, that we began to find out that as we kept moving forward and not giving up, we were very dedicated. I know you said that on Sunday about how we made that decision that church was nothing would take the place of that. We made that decision with a little bit of opposition, but we said, no, on Sunday, this is it. We're going to go to church. And we've been to church for how many, 40-something years?
40-plus.
Every Sunday. The only time we stopped was last year when COVID shut everything down. That was the first time we actually didn't go to church in that 40 years. But it's through the, you know, knowing the call of God on your life actually brings you to that place to serve. And I always think about Jesus. He's the greatest example of, he said, I did not come to be served. He could have. He could have said, I'm the king, I'm the Messiah, but he did not come to be served. He came to serve the people.
I think it's important to grasp or comprehend Jesus' heart of a servant. That's why he demonstrated it by washing the feet of the disciples. It wasn't that he just did that one thing in 3.5 years.
No.
He actually lived that life. And he did serve them. As much as he led them as a leader, he also served them, and he made an example of his own life. And, you know, today it hasn't changed. He wants to be great in the kingdom of God. Let that person learn to become a servant of all. You got to learn it. Some people just don't have it in them, but you can learn. You know, if you see me doing something, you can jump in and help me. You can work with me. And so servanthood is, I believe, a part of what we observe, I think, in ministry. The people that are serving the most are the ones that are growing the most.
Yeah.
It's almost without exception, the ones that aren't serving in any form, we find are in very go slow mode of growth or plateaued. They just don't change year after year. Nothing seems to move. But the ones that are serving, who are heartfelt, I'm jumping in, I'll do whatever it takes. Because when we say we love God and we serve God, when we serve God, we actually also serve his body. Jesus is the head, we are the body. So you serve the body, and then after the body, you serve outside in the community.
That's right.
Yeah.
And if you think of the book of Acts, where I think it's the book of Acts, where they're talking about the church was growing and there was some problems there. They were praying and giving themselves to the word, and they kind of had to come to a place where they had to choose, and they were told, choose, you know, serving. I think about this, if you put this together with serving, think about how important serving is to God. They were told, choose 7 men from among you, full of the Holy Spirit and a good reputation to serve. So think about that. When you serve, it's expected that you are full of the Holy Spirit. That's how you serve, you know, with a heart of joy, with a heart of gladness, with a heart that you're doing it, number one, for God, and two, God, you know, has a pattern. He says, love him, love people. So if you love God, you will also love people. So that's the pattern, isn't it, to serve. So you're serving God, but you're also serving the body and finding your place in the body. So I believe that's really important. The call and serving go hand in hand.
I think it's such a good point that they picked seven men full of the Holy Spirit. In other words, if you're just a great cook, but you're not full of the Holy Spirit, you didn't qualify. Yeah.
No.
But if you're a great cook and you're full of the Holy Spirit, they know you're going to, even though if it's hot in the kitchen, even though, there's hundreds of people waiting, while you're chopping potatoes and making stews and making meals and all that, you're going to be humming a song. It's going to be a joyful atmosphere around you, not a heavy duty, oh my goodness, there's more coming in, you know, like a reluctant heart. So they were looking for people that were not reluctant, that were fully
a good reputation,
happy to do whatever it takes. No matter if it's, we're going to finish cleaning up here at 10 o'clock at night, that's all fine. You know, there's a heart of a willingness. I think that scripture that we used on Sunday, that my people shall be willing.
Volunteers
in the day of my
power.
The day of my power is every day that I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. That's the power in me, and I can serve joyfully, willingly, without getting cranky and start to throw tables around and chairs around and start being abrasive to people and letting them know that you're not happy. They wanted seven men full of the Holy Spirit.
And a good reputation.
So really good.
So that goes hand in hand. And when you know you're full of the Holy Spirit, a good reputation, you will find the call of God and whatever God has for you in that future, because sometimes it changes in our life. And the very last thing we spoke about was embracing the season. So for us, the season looked different at the beginning, and on our journey in that 30 years is very different today. What we do today isn't necessarily what we did 30 years ago, but we've gone on from there. We've learned a lot. We're still learning a lot, but we're embracing the season that we're in now, that we're partnering with God, and that he, as he pours out his Spirit and he helps us to continue moving forward. So embracing the season, we're in a season of raising royals, we're in a season of raising up leaders and seeing people. I believe we're in the moment at this time of equipping the saints for the work of the ministry.
How good is that?
Yep.
Embracing the season. Because seasons, we know there's natural seasons, summer, autumn, winter, spring, and we expect certain things to happen in those seasons. But God also has seasons for us. Some of them are not to be repeated, like the weather seasons. What I was doing 30 years ago, 20 years ago, certain items in my life where I heard God say, you're not to do that anymore. And I didn't understand then. Some things I still don't understand why not, but I know that I heard, and I was very happy to let things go, and I did numerous times. I can think of four specific areas. I won't go into it, but I heard God say, even though it's successful, even though it's going well, your time is up in that season. And sometimes if we're able to lay it down, that means you are literally something in my hands. This is my season. But if he says your season is over, I need to be able to put it down so that my hands can be open and ready to receive the next season. If you can't let go of that old season, your hands are full and he can't give you what he wants to give you. Your next season is going to be better, in the sense, because it's in obedience to God. So our hands need to be emptied and say, Lord, whatever you want.
Yeah, that's so true. And you know, it's like a season, you know, summer's gone. I'm glad about that. But the other night I went out to hang clothes, and I just love the change of the seasons. We don't have the color, like, you know, the beautiful rusty colors and the golden, you know, the leaves that change color. But I went outside the other night and I was pegging some clothes out, and I just stopped for a moment and I could feel the breeze coming on my face, and I thought, oh, the seasons change. So, you know, in our life, we know the season changes when the breath of the Holy Spirit breathes upon us and we feel the fresh wind of His Spirit coming on us, and we know, and we just know, above everything else, that we are in that new season. And I believe we are in that new season, and I can feel the wind of the Holy Spirit blowing upon everything that we're doing, And I actually believe we're seeing it. So, you know, today we want to encourage you in your walk with God. We want to encourage you that you fulfill the purpose that you are on this earth for. And remember, 1 Peter 2:9 says that you are a royal priesthood, a chosen generation, a holy people, a people that belong to God. So every one of us, every man, woman, and child has a purpose and a destiny in their life, and we pray that you will fulfill it. Have a great week in your circles, and remember to enjoy your time together and see, and just see the growth in each other, and have a blessed week. Love you all, and we'll see you soon.
God bless you all.
Thank you for joining us here on the Royals YouTube channel. Don't forget to like, comment and subscribe. And if this has blessed you, feel free to share it with your friends and family. We can't wait to see you next time for another glorious gathering.